don't suppose I'll ever forget one of the first write-ups I ever got in New York City. I don't know how many of you have ever seen the magazine called Q, C-U-E. But they had a column on mostly for music. And after I'd been at Jimmy Rhine's a little while, somebody told me, Art Q is going to cover you one of these days. Now, if you've ever seen this magazine, you'll know that in this column, mostly for music, the print is so small. In order to get in everything that they want to tell about what's happening, or at least was happening then, that you need a good magnifying glass to see your name. Well, one night, at work, somebody says, well, you're in Q. So between sets, I ran over to Broadway, to a newsstand, and I bought the Q magazine. But I didn't read it. I saved that for after work. This I was going to relish. Well, impatient, finally, work is over. And I have walked a few blocks away and walked into a restaurant, a one-armed place, just a counter. There might have been a few tables, but it was a long counter, this I remember, and a narrow restaurant. I also remember it was on 6th Avenue, near Radio City. It's a populated neighborhood, but that time in the morning, like 4 o'clock, it was depopulated. And I sat down at the counter and ordered my cup of coffee. I don't know what else. Now, this was at the end of the night, mind you, and I'm sure I was feeling no pain. I sit beginning to getting ready to look at my big write-up. And I mean, I really had to squint. This was before the time I was started to use eyeglasses. I really squinted to see this thing. And you know, I'm really in a world all of my own. I must have been sitting there at least a half hour. I don't remember too much. I remember a guy sitting down the counter from me. And I remember somebody going to the telephone. That's about all I remember except watching my write-up. Until the gendarmes arrived. It seems that that guy sitting down from the counter, down the counter from me, had waited for an appropriate moment and then held up the place. He did it real smoothly. And you know, I had a hell of a time convincing the cops that I wasn't in on it. I mean, it sounds silly to tell them I'm reading this little write-up. And while I know I must have been stoned, but I really didn't see nothing or hear nothing. And they called up Jimmy Rhines. Got him out of bed somewhere. And he verified my story. You meet a lot of people in show business, and especially if you're in New York. Some of them are very interesting. True enough. an agent by the name of Sheila Dilly. I was introduced to Gloria Swanson. And a little later, we were rehearsing during the daytime at the Village Vanguard. Now, any nightclub in the daytime smells like stale beer while they're cleaning it up, and that's kind of a sad smell. But here she came down there, and Elliot Nugent, the actor, he came too. He was part of this deal. And Max Kaminsky was on trumpet, Freddie Moore. And we rehearsed these one-minute transcriptions. You know, something about, I loved here Art Hodes and his trio. Play that boogie-woogie music, it makes me feel so good. When I'm taking my bath and I'm using these antihistamine or whatever it was, pills, you know, that took a minute to talk about it. But a lot of silliness, really, but I'm sure it had its place and its purpose. And I didn't think it was silly when I got paid. Point I like to make is, what a nice person she was. Never complain about where we had to rehearse, about the odor of the beer and all that. She was just so easy. I was to find that out many times, that the people who had arrived, who were really somebody in themselves, were very easy to work with. I met that and had nothing to do with work. I guess I'm sure I must have met him through Sheila, because she dealt with showbiz personalities. Was Richard Dyer Bennett, the father of Connie Bennett. He spent three nights, maybe it'd been day and night, teaching me how to drink like a gentleman. He didn't succeed, but I learned all about eating oysters and seafood. And he was a beautiful person, too. The characters in jazz, the people that give jazz that special something it has, really deserve a place in our memory. Some of them are around and doing fine. One is Wild Bill Davison. I'm sure Wild Bill deserves the title. A lot of people don't know that Wild Bill is a collector. He likes to collect things. And I think many times he doesn't realize that he's doing it. There was a time I was in his house with a friend. Friend looks down on the coffee table and sees a lighter, and he says, "My gosh, I was wondering where my lighter went." And Bill came in just at that moment and says, "Oh, is that yours?" He didn't think anything more about it. But the funny story on Bill was, Eddie Condon brought a group to Constitution Hall in Philadelphia to do a concert. I think the Daughters of the American Revolution kind of rose up in their grave and objected, but somehow the concert went on. And it was successful. Bill was on the date, Pee Wee Russell. But after the date, there was a hue and cry in the newspapers. It seems that a certain very valuable piece of writing, it was a framed document where the composer Sibelius had complimented the Philadelphia Orchestra on the way they had played his music. That was kind of a important, certainly was important to the people involved. Well, it disappeared after the concert. So the paper, one of the papers grabbed the story, the document disappears. Well, the way I got the story was from Pee Wee. It was the next day that Pee Wee was up in his apartment and something impelled him to, you know, take out his clarinet and, you know, clean it, see how, check it out, you know. And just about the time he was beginning to do this, the doorbell rang and it was Bill, Wild Bill. And Bill walked in without a word, walked up to the clarinet case, picked up one part of it, I should say, and just out of the inside, rolled up, was this piece of parchment. Of course, when Eddie heard about it, he got him to give it back, and it was just another one of those things where Bill says, "Oh, was that there?" The thing we always say about Wild Bill, that's funny, he makes every woman from the age of 2 to 82 feel wanted. Of course, aside from all this, this cat can blow his horn, you know. And he really works at it. Dedicated to the music. Then we had Brad Gowans, the trombone player, who was always inventing things. And I remember a date I'd booked, which I was going to bring an all-star band to the University in Michigan, at Ann Arbor, and then on to Chicago at Silhouette Club. And I had Brad and Pee Wee. At the last minute, I got kind of worried because I'd heard Brad was building a car. Actually, what he did was found this old Rolls Royce in Connecticut and had it towed to New York City. Whatever was on the car, he started putting two of everything. You know, like two mufflers, just double everything so he'd get twice as much power. Now, if you can imagine Pee Wee Russell helping him build this car. They had it at some garage on 7th Avenue or some gas station. They set this thing off. The police got a lot of calls. Windows came open. It went off with such a bang. The thing actually ran. Two carburetors. I forgot to mention that. It was written up in Time magazine. Brad was thinking about driving it to my gigs. I got very worried, you know, and I told him, mm-mm, you'll have to fly if you want this job. But the scene, I'm thinking of Pee Wee helping around a car. Well, if you knew Pee Wee, I've never seen Pee Wee do anything but blow the clarinet, bend an elbow. As I say, the cats in jazz are very interesting, and for various reasons, different reasons. guitar player. When we were up in Lawrence, Massachusetts, I found out he was interested in building a house. Brick by brick. I'm kidding. But I'm not kidding about the fact that he was great with a deck of cards and we were apt pupils. We just couldn't be convinced that he knew that much. We thought he was just lucky. George Brunus, he thought, this man is lucky. And every night we'd come and take lessons. And that's what I mean, brick by brick. We were buying that house for him, brick by brick. Jack was a kind of a funny cat. He'd be sitting down in this big theater restaurant that we played in. And suddenly he'd look way up there and see a light missing. And he'd climb all those balconies and go up there and get a light from the boss and replace it. That boss loved Jack. He finally got out of the business. The last I heard, he was driving a cab out in California somewhere. Cless was more of the solemn type. But he had a dry sense of humor. Many people don't know this. It came to a surprise to me that he had married Bud Freeman's sister. But when I met him, this was all over. Really got to know him in New York. He had a dry sense of humor. He would always talk about, wouldn't it be nice if I could stay home and just drink my booze and listen to my records and send my choruses to work for me. Some cats that I met didn't turn me on so well. Like the first time, probably the only time I met Bob Zurke was in Chicago at the Liberty Inn. Somebody says, do you mind if this cat sits in? Well, I kind of wondered, who's this cat that's that great that they want him to sit in for me? But I got up and he sat in. Man, he liked to drove me crazy. He had two hands, you know, and they're both moving. His message didn't kill me, you know. I mean, what he had to say, I mean, didn't turn me on like blues, but he could sure use his hands and he could sure fire up a place. It's funny, I never did get back to that piano. Inn was a place for musicians to come because they could sit in there and they could hang around, and it was very painless money-wise. I mean, like, if I recall correctly, you could get a shot of gin if you was a musician for like 5 cents. Imagine that. We really drew the musicians. Sometimes I look up on that stand and there'd be three trumpet players. Wingy Manone, Marty Marcella. And the cat from the New Orleans Rhythm Kings, the trumpet player, who I got to know very well, and yet his name escapes me. All three blown at the same time. Dave Tuff used to hang around there a lot. And I remember the time our drummer, whose name was Earl Wiley, and was a periodic drinker, decided that the period had arrived. We never knew when the period would arrive. It was one of those things. Now, Earl was one of the great drummers that I played with. Just like Clancy Hayes is one of the great Dixieland singers, probably the only one. Earl was a riverboat drummer. I never heard a man play drums just like he. First place, he was a dancer. So he had the rhythm right into his feet. And the beats he'd made, he'd worked many circuses. So when those cooch dancers would get up and dance, he would have to make the kind of beat that would stimulate them. And he'd really mastered that. And Earl was also great on woodblocks, on playing on the rims, things you don't hear much today. Well, this day Earl was not so great. He was feeling no pain. And we thought, well, we're lucky anyway. Davy Tuff is here. Now, when Earl started drinking, everyone was his friend, and he bought drinks for everybody. And what the McGoverns did was follow him around, because they knew sooner or later he would pick up his drums and take them to the first pawn shop and pawn them. And then they'd redeem the tickets. They'd pick up the tickets. The end of Earl's act, of course, usually they'd have to pump his stomach. I mean, this man really would consume. And then after that, he was all right. Never touched a drop for the longest time. It'd be nice to get along with too. Well, this night we were in trouble. Until somebody says, Dave Tuff is here, we're all right. Well, after the first set with Dave Tuff, somebody says, hey, Earl, come on back. Your sub is drunker than you are.